Welcome to the third module of this course. In this module, we are going to look at different kinds of data flow frameworks. What we have done in the first module is looked at the simplest kind of data flow frameworks, which are Bitvector data flow frameworks. Then we generalized the observations made in Bitvector data flow frameworks and created a theory that can be used to talk about general data flow frameworks. So now it's time for us to apply that theory and look at more modern, more relevant data flow analyses and see how the theory helps us. What we're going to do in this module is we will first look at why what we have seen so far is still insufficient to model general flows and what are the two new concepts of flow functions that we need to learn in order to model general flows. Then we will look at these four data flow frameworks. Constant propagation, we have already seen the example of constant propagation to motivate the need for a general setting. We already seen the example of constant propagation to understand non-distributivity of flow functions. Then we look at another interesting data flow analysis called strong live variables analysis, which is a generalization of live variables analysis. It basically eliminates the need of performing live variables analysis and then dead code elimination, then the next round of live variables analysis. It takes the transitive effect of liveness and does one analysis once and for all, and then we can do all the dead code elimination. And after that, if you perform any live variables analysis, we're not going to find any new dead code. After that, we're going to look at pointer analysis, and we're going to spend a lot of time on pointer analysis. Pointer analysis is very close to our heart. It's the topic on which a lot of research is happening in my group here. So we will spend considerable time on pointer analysis. Subject to availability of time, I will also talk about the research problems that my PhD students and my master's students are trying to tackle in pointer analysis. We will conclude this model, this module with heap reference analysis. So let's begin with precise modeling of general flows. We had seen this motivating example at the end of second module, asking a question, how many iterations are required in order to perform constant propagation for this particular example. Note that we had seen the concept of depth for Bitvector frameworks, which is defined as the maximum number of backages in an acyclic paths. Here we have just one backage. So the depth of this graph is 1, which means that for Bitvector frameworks, 1 plus 2 iterations are sufficient to detect that we have reached the convergence. We have seen that in the end of the module 2. And then we ask a question, how many iterations are required for constant propagation? So we just observe that at the end of the first iteration, we discover that D is bottom. This is because D is defined to be 2 here, and we are reading D as the input and we don't know what value will be read. So we conservatively assume that the value of D is bottom in constant propagation. So this value of D is then used to define the value of C. So in the second iteration, we discovered that C is bottom. It's easy to imagine that in the third iteration, we discover that B is bottom. And it's in the fourth iteration that we discover that A is bottom. Note that one more iteration is required to propagate this value of A being bottom from the end of basic block 2 to the entry of basic block 2 via this backage. The question is that if Bitvector data flow framework can converge in D plus 1 iteration, of course plus 1 iteration for detecting convergence. So D plus 1 here is 2. Why is it that constant propagation requires 5 iterations for convergence? So that 4 iterations for discovering A is bottom and one more iteration for marking A's bottom and the entry of node 2. So a total of 5 iterations. So why is it that constant propagation requires 5 iterations, whereas all bit vector frameworks that we've seen so far could converge in D plus 1 iterations, which is 2 iterations. So we want to look at this concept. This question is answered by looking at the concept of loop closure of a flow function. Imagine a certain control flow graph. This is program point P1, this is program point P2, and this is program point P3. Imagine that the flow function, the effective flow function of this loop is f. We now know that all flow functions in our function space are closed under composition. So we can, even if there is a large number of basic blocks here, we can imagine that we can at least mathematically represent the effect of this part of the program by a single flow function. If you look at the paths terminating at P2, one path is from P1 to P2 and the data flow value is x. The other path is from P1 to P2 to P3 and then coming back to P2. So P1 to P2 to P3 and coming back to P2. And the data flow value that this path brings is f of x. If we were to traverse the loop once again, that is P1 to P2 to P3, again to P2 and then again to P3 and then again P2. So if we traverse this loop once and then twice, then the data flow value that this brings is f of x, which we denote as f squared x. If you were to iterate yet another time, we get f cube of x. And the point is, we're doing static analysis and we do not know how many times the loop will have to be iterated. Recall that we say that all conditions are equally probable, so therefore we cannot say that after so many traversals, we don't have to traverse this back edge again. So what happens then is that we have to consider all possible traverse, all possible infinite unfoldings of the loop in order to compute a value statically. So we need to summarize the value at P2 by a value which is safe after any iteration, in an infinite number of iterations. So we denote this value by f star of x. F star of x is x, which is coming along this path, f of x, which is coming along one unfolding, merged with f square x, merged with f cube x, merged with f4 x. So what we wish to compute for static analysis is this loop closure, which means that x merged with fx, merged with f square x, merged with f cube x, an infinite number of times. And clearly, we ought to be able to say that these loop closures exist and loop closures are computed. So, f star is called the loop closure of f, and we talk about the boundedness of loop closure. For practical data flow analysis, we require the loop closures to be bounded, which means that there should exist some k for every function f in our function space. There must exist some k such that f star x is equal to x meet fx meet f square x meet fk minus 1, meaning that k terms, a meet of k terms is equal to a meet of infinitely many terms. It's easy to imagine that such a number exists because we are assuming that descending chain condition is satisfied, meaning there exists a finite number of terms which will give the meet of all infinite terms. The question is this number constant or does this number vary with flow function? We require practically that this number must be constant, known a priori, and should not vary from function to function, should not vary from one program that we are analyzing to the other program should be a property of the data flow framework. And it should be independent of the size of the lattice. So, if we observe this term in bit vector frameworks, we observe that we have f square f star x computed like this. So we know f of x is equal to gen union x minus kill. So when we compute f square of x, we apply f to f of x, which is gen union x minus kill. And now we take this whole thing as x. So what do we get? We will get this term gen. So we have gen union x minus kill. This whole term is now x. So we get gen union x minus kill minus kill, which we can simplify it using here we are subtracting kill from this term. So we can subtract kill from gen and we can subtract kill from x. And now we can open up the bracket and we get gen union x minus kill. And gen minus kill is same as gen. So we get gen union x minus kill and we get f of x. So we know that f square x is equal to f of x and therefore f cube x will also be f of x. And so we know that no matter how many times we might apply the flow function f to x, we are going to not get any new data flow value, which means that f star x is equal to f meet f of x. Note that in this equation, the meet did not play any role. This meet could have been union, this meet could have been intersection. Because we know that f square x is same of f of x, so fx meet fx, we will just get fx because meet is idempotent. So what we've learned so far is that loop closures of bit vector frameworks are two bounded. So therefore, only one traversal over the loop is sufficient. Note that when I say one traversal over the loop, I mean the entire looping path. If the entire looping path has k back edges, then a round robin iteration might require k traversals over the program. But on the entire looping path, we need only one traversal. If the entire looping path consists of a single back edge, then just one traversal over the control flow graph. If it consists of two back edges in the same acyclic segment, then we will need two traversals over the control flow path to complete one traversal over this looping path. It's easy to see why loop closures in bit vector frameworks are two bounded. The intuition is simple. Gen and kill are constants, which means that the same things are generated or killed in every application of f. So if we apply f once again, we are not going to add anything new that was not added earlier. We're not going to remove something that was not removed earlier. So therefore, subsequent applications of f may not be required. So multiple applications of f do not give any new value unless the input value changes, and we are fixing input value to x. So that is the reason why loop closures in bit vector frameworks are. So now let's see why constant propagation is different. So there's a term called fast frameworks traditionally, which says that all two bounded frameworks, for example, bit vector frameworks, and for these frameworks, these conditions must be satisfied. Something called separability, which we will look at very shortly, which says that data flow values or different entities are independent and the flow functions are either constant functions or identity flow functions. Flow functions for an entity can produce either a fixed known value a priori, or they simply are identity functions, thereby they simply propagate the values. When one of these conditions is violated, we get non-fast frameworks. Fast and propagation is an example of a framework which is not from here. So we want to talk about the concept of separability. We know that a flow function f is a function from L to L, and this L itself is a tuple for each expression or each variable or each bit vector. So we can see a function itself as a tuple of m functions, where the function hi shown with a hat, hi hat, computes the value of xi in the component lattice. So let's look at examples of separable and non-separable frameworks. Let's try to model them. So we have, let's say, we have m variables or m expressions or m definitions, and we're talking about on bit vector frameworks. When we apply f to these m values, x1 cap, x2 cap, up to xn cap, we get y1 cap, y2 cap, up to ym cap. Here also in non-separable frameworks, once again we may have m variables or whatever entities whose analysis we are performing, and we get this. So at the higher level, both the functions are taking a value in L and are and producing a result which is another value in L. However, the mechanism of computing these values is subtly different. The important point in separable frameworks are that there exists an hcap2 function which will read the second element in the input tuple and will produce the value in the second element in the output tuple, which means that we have a function which will perhaps talk about x and will give us the will talk about a variable v and will give us the value of that variable v. So for example, when we do live variables analysis, we know that there is one part of the function that will look at whether variable A is live at the exit, and it will only talk about variable A. This small function, which we call as an entity function, will not worry about variable B. So if you have a set A, B, C, effectively there is a function that will compute the liveness of A, there's another function that will compute the liveness of B, there's another function that will compute the liveness of C, and the overall function is just a combination of these functions. The important point is liveness of A is sufficient. Liveness of only A at the exit of a node is sufficient to compute the liveness of A at the entry of the node. Availability of expression A star B is at the entry of a node is sufficient to compute the availability of the expression A star B at the exit of a node by looking at what's happening within the node. However, in case of a non-separable framework, what happens is something funny. We again have a function that computes the value of a given entity, but it cannot compute the value of the second entity only from the second entity. Instead, it needs to read the values of other entities as well. An example is constant propagation. So for constant propagation, if we have a statement A is equal to B plus C, the constantness of A will require us to read the constantness of B as well as constantness of C in order before we can conclude whether or not A is constant after this assignment. So in case of separable frameworks, this hcap function is a function from the component lattice L cap to L cap, which is the value of a single entity, to a value of single entity. Here h hat or h cap function is a value, is a function from a value in L to L cap, which means that in order to compute the value of one element in the output tuple, we might need the values of many elements in the input tuple. So that is the difference between the separable or non-separable frameworks. Constant propagation is non-separable. occur. And this is the reason why constant propagation is not too bounded and it needs a larger number of iterations over the program. Before we look at that, let's come back to bitvector frameworks. In bitvector frameworks, we know that our L cap, the component lattice, is just 0, 1 lattice. False and true. That's the lattice. And overall lattice is a product lattice of 0, 1 raised to m if there are n entities. The meet operation is either Boolean and or a Boolean of. Top and bottom values are 0 or 1 depending upon what the meet lattice is. And h is a bit function. It takes one bit value and produces value in a single bit, and it could be any of the following. So now we are talking about functions from 0, 1 to 0, 1 or functions from top and bottom to top and bottom. So we might have a function which takes a top value, maps it to top value, also takes a bottom value and maps it to the top value. This function, let's call it as a raise function. No matter what the input value is, output value is always the top value. So it's an example of a constant function. Regardless of what the input value is, output value is fixed. The other possibility is that this function might take a top value as the input and might produce bottom value as the output. And it might take the bottom value also and again might produce the bottom value, which means that again, regardless of the input, it produces a fixed value, which is a bottom value. So this is another example of a constant function. A third kind of a function that is possible is that it might take top value and produce a top value. It might take bottom value as an input and map it to the bottom value. So this is a propagate function. It just propagates the value. So this is an identity function. And a fourth function that is possible. Note that we have two input values, two output values. So we can have at most four possible functions. So the fourth function is that we might take top value and top value might produce bottom value. And bottom value might produce top value. This function is non-monotonic. This negate function is non-monotonic. And I will leave it for you to create examples and see why non-monotonicity is violated by this function. So what I'm trying to say is the entire first module that we have seen of bitvector frameworks is just a game of these three very simple functions. We had these three very simple functions, we combined the effect of these functions, and everything that we did over whatever number of weeks that we spent on bitvector frameworks, we are simply playing with these three simplest kinds of functions. Let's come back to constant propagation. For constant propagation, loop closures are not too bounded. Loop closures have a higher value. So the summary flow function for this can be represented by given an input value of A, B, C and D. So VA is the value of A, VB is the value of B, VC is the value of C and VD is the value of D. Note that there is a value in the constant propagation lattice. So it could be top, which is undefined or empty set of values, or bottom, which is non-constant or all possible values, or a single constant value in between. So it could be any of these values. So we have a function which takes four of these values, each corresponding to A, B, C, D, and then produces the values of A, B, C, D. So VA is the first component. So A is equal to B plus 1. So the value of A is computed as, so VA is equal to VB plus 1. Similarly, VB is equal to VC plus 1. So this is the second component. Its value is VC plus 1. VC is the third component and its value is VD plus 1. And D is the fourth component. VD is the fourth value of D, which is the fourth component, and its value is fixed at 2. So this is the effect of this flow function. Let's examine how this flow function executes. So if we were to compute f of top, so we want to see that this function is not too bounded. If we were to compute f of top, because vb is top, therefore va will be top. Because vc is top, therefore vb will be top. And because vd is top, therefore vc will be top. However, vd is fixed at 2. So therefore, f of top gives us top and 2. Now, when we apply f to it once again, note that now we are applying f square, which means that f to this. So this value of d now is not top anymore, it is 2, and therefore value of c will be vd plus 1, which is 2 plus 1, which is 3. So this value from here to here is flowing into this component and giving us a new value. So this is the result that we get in f square. It's easy to see that f square is not equal to f square x is not equal to f of x. Now f cube x in turn flows the value of c into the value of b by adding value of c into the value of b by adding 1 to that value. So we get 4. F4 pushes this value of 4 into 5 now, right? And f5 now gives us the same value. So this is an example of a flow function which is not too long. Of course, we have assumed that the values coming here are from top. I leave it as an exercise for you to imagine how many traversals would be required, how many applications would be required if the values coming in the loop from outside the loop, if the values are whatever. So we have this exercise that shows us that the loop closures in constant propagation are not too bad. This completes our introduction to precise modeling of general flows. The next part of the lecture deals with constant